of the third meeting.
Green flag at the back, so hopefully we'll get away this time. Oh, they didn't mess around this time, and away they go. And the pole sitting Cobra makes a fantastic start. I think should be well into the lead.
Here comes Pirro.
Pirro storming down the inside. Is it going to be Cobra 1-2 into the first corner? Yes, it is.
Yeah, Pirro through into second place. And look at Beaton trying to go around the outside and lightweight to land.
Very good. Had a third bad start, Marcus.
Yeah, but here's the Ferrari. That's the key. That's Pastorelli trying to work his way past. Well, there's the LM Ferrari coming down the inside. There's the Debra in the middle. LM Ferrari wheel to wheel with Meaden in the gunmetal coloured Lotus Elan. And as they come down through Ford Waters, Horst Berries, that's Richard Mines in the Jaguar.
Well, he's lost about when he was third on the grid. He's back in fifth and a real challenge at the front. Pirro's right on the tail of Michael Gans. The red Cobra pushing very hard. The black Cobra at the front, in third place, Mike Jordan in the TBR. And then really fantastic angle cars, and that LM going beautifully. Car number 25, Gary Pearson. We'll hand over to John later in the race, but Dickie Meaden in the little Lotus will really try and keep him honest.
The maroon Cobra is that of the Youngs, isn't it? Which is John Young. We saw finish a very good fourth in the Jack Brabham Cedar race earlier on. But it's Gans who leads Pirro from Whittaker. Then it is Haddon, then it is John Young. Diving down the inside of the E-type into Woodgate comes the Ferrari.
From 13th on the grid, Marcus, he's
at
the top six.
He's on a charge. Richard Mines is behind him, then it's James Hilliard. Behind James Hilliard, the Ginetta, the 8 engine, is the Lan. Here comes Pastorelli, hurtling past one of the E-type. A little bit vaguer, he's gone past, and up onto the tail again of Andrew Hall. In the Bizzarini, that's Joaquin Falk, the Spaniard from Barcelona, driving the Aston Martin project car.
Well, there's a bit of down at the middle order, project Aston Martin ahead of the DB4 GT Aston Martin, Adrian Wilmot on the wheel of that. But out front, Michael Gans, being pushed very hard indeed by Emanuele Pirro. They're dropping those behind. The Bizzarini, you can see just in front of the 250 GTOs, the 64 model, the longer tail, and well, certainly Nicky Pastorelli fancies going past through St Mary's, having a look. I think he might go up the inside when they get to Lavant. That's certainly the classic line. Not quite close enough. It'd be foolish on the second lap of the race to make a move, but certainly he's letting the Bizzarini driver know he is right there in behind it.
Oh, and he gets a run on the second part of onto the Lavant straight there, and I think as he made it through the side by side.
Fantastic.
Drag race there, I think he's going to do it.
Pizzarini and LM side by side abreast through the kink.
Britt Vega came through in 12th, so Sam Hancock may have some work to do when he climbs aboard the number 29 E-type, as the two Cobras come through already drawing clear of Whittaker in the TBR, Cobra in 4th and 5th, and then it's Gary Pearson in the 250 LM.
Like a traffic jam, Kevin, through the chicane. There's one long peloton strung out behind the behind the race leaders.
Richard Mines is losing ground a little bit. He was seventh on the start-finish line, but he's certainly being chased and harried very hard indeed. There is the Bizzarini we were looking at before, 66. And that is in the thick of the action again. It's in white DB4 GT. Every sort of shape of car, every sort of shape of E-type as well. But it's getting closer and closer at the front, maybe half a second. It was half a second on the start-finish line between first and second, and I'd say it's exactly the same at St Mary's. Those AC Cobras escaping at the front.
There's a gaggle of Shelby Mustangs running here, at least three of them in the midfield pack. And Falk has got, he's under attack from the DB4 GT, which is Adrian Wilmot, isn't it? The number five car that was biffed a little last year. There is 85 Richard Meaden attacking Richard Mines on the inside. Oh. One way through is his water crossing. Two wheels off over the grass.
It worked, didn't it? But it did, I think work. He's going to now be outpowered by the E-type down the Lavant straight. Well, I tell you what, it's the Lavant's pretty quick in the straight line. Very low frontal area, of course. So cuts are nice. But the E-type has come past. Oh, battle under braking. And Meaden secures the place around the outside. So he had to work hard for that, but he has finally overcome the Mines E-type.
A long time in the making, wasn't it?
It was. And now he's got a big gap to catch the lead. The lead half dozen, which have broken a long way away, while Mines has been really holding up the gaggle cars, actually.
Yeah, but look at the gap that already has opened out, his mind hangs back, and certainly Dickie Meaton had to be brave. He's made it pay, now he's going to escape. But look at this lead battle, they're way clear of the rest. It's 3.5 seconds clear at the start, finish line off the chasing pack, but still out front, Michael Gantz, Emanuele Pirro, doing everything he can to take the red and white Wilmette livery AC Cobra to the front of this race. And with three completed laps, 3.5 laps under their belts, he's getting closer and closer. Fastest lap of the race so far, 1:27.1. That's quick at this stage in a 45-minute race.
Yeah, Gary Pearce has just set the fastest first sector of all in the 250LM, so he's really getting it wound up now in his first race. And his next target is the 24 young car in fifth.
Pastorelli with the ignition key tag banging on his knee as he drives along. It'll be irritating, wouldn't it? He's now attacking James Hilliard with the Ginetta. And of course, the Ferrari into the apex of Lavant, getting bang on the loud pedal.
Hilliard very happy to let the Ginetta run to the edge of the circuit, but doesn't, you know, it's that combination of trying to keep your foot in and yet still trying to get the car to turn in. And I'd say there's sort of some degree of compromise there, the little Ginetta. So Richard Mines, busy first, and he's got the Ginetta right on his side. Oh, big twitch from Pastorelli there. He nearly caught the tail of the Hilliard Ginetta down through Woodcut.
That well was to avoid it,
absolutely
it?
So. Did you see the way the key fob was swinging around?
I was busy watching to see where the Ginetta was, frankly.
So was I.
It's like a fairground ride, this, isn't it? We're on board.
You have to feel quite good if you've chosen the right car to put your forward-facing onboard camera on.
Smacks the next gear in there, going up past the pits. Here's the leading cars, and it's difficult to believe in some ways. You've got Michael Gans, who runs a little bit wide there, but he's essentially an amateur, driving against a five-time Le Mans winner who's raced in every level of single-seater racing and is at the top of his game still in Storix.
Do you get the impression that Pirro's body is timing a little bit, perhaps letting them break away?
Pastorelli's through.
Chasing pack.
Got down out of Ford water. He's gone past Hilliard in the Ginetta, and now looks to square up to Richard Mines at 7.
Yeah, now this is the chance for things to change. Traffic, they finally reached it, and it's not where they wanted to find it. Number 5, absolutely in their way, which is the E-type Jaguar in their path, just really didn't want it. I think it's number 8 actually.
Yes, well, Gans was so delayed that so was Pirro, because he had to massively get out of it as well. They've actually stopped in the chicane and then started a drag race down the start-finish straight and ended up pretty much where they'd been beforehand.
So. Well, it won't be the last car they meet, but in fact, that was starting right towards the tail. This is the second last qualifier, so it was one of the slower cars, and it really, really caught them out. And don't forget, of course, this year the chicane is much more solid. So very much a race ender if you go into it, whereas before you might have survived.
All that has allowed is Whittaker to... Oh, and
Pastorelli up inside Richard Mines.
Didn't make it.
No.
Looked as though the job was done.
It did.
Pirro's ever closer to Michael Gans fighting for the lead of the race, but this is mesmerising stuff. Now look how close he is. He's one car length behind. Where's the next bit of traffic they're going to meet? That's the question. Where they don't want it, of course, is at the chicane. And you know what? I think that might be where they next find it. So Gans still leading in the 94 Cobra, being pushed super hard by Emanuele Pirro in the number 13 red and white Wilmette livery car.
What that moment of the chicane did do, Bruce, is allow Mark Whittaker to take a second and a half out of them. So the time he'd been losing, he's got a little bit of it back.
You never know when that's going to come in handy. Good news indeed.
Yeah, they are absolutely nose to tail. And Pirro looks so relaxed in the second place car.
No histrionics, that's for sure.
We saw Michael Gans at Silverstone Classic a couple of years ago weather enormous pressure up front in the dark green Cobra, looked after by Andy Wolf's Wolf Manufacturing team.
Yes, Pirro had a look down the inside, didn't he, and saw all the cement dust and thought, that's probably not a good idea at this stage of the race, and slotted back in behind again.
Yes, I think he's on a fact-finding mission, just trying to line up where the best points to overtake, but of course the fact they can't factor in is traffic, where they'll find it, how fast they'll be travelling. It's really, they are as equal can be as they lap at the moment. Cobras 1 and 2 leading the race.
Pastorelli in the 1-1-1, Ferrari up into 8th place. Mines now 9th in 14th. 10th is Hilliard in the Ginetta, and number 82, 11th Fogg in the number 2 Aston, and 12th, 72, which is Jamie Boot.
And Pearson has taken the LM up into 5th place now.
Yeah, went through on that last lap. TBR.
Finding some Mile business. Yeah, it's about 3 seconds down from the leading duo, helped by the little fumble of the chicane a lap and a half ago. This time, first and second get through the chicane without any interruption at all, but Whittaker sitting on a 1.5 second advantage over the Haddon Shuffler, number 6 Cobra. See in the back of your shot, the big red one.
Quarter of a second, but you wouldn't have thought that as they go into Maverick corner, into that double apex right, it rises tantalisingly in the middle, the front car dances through, right hand front wheel in the air, and Michael Gans weathers the storm. He's not that far ahead of Ralphie Haddon in the number 6 Cobra, the red Cobra. Whittaker did his best lap last time through, 27.3.
A little bit of smoke out of the back of Mike Jordan's TBR, but I think it was just the bodywork as the car rolled going out of St Mary's. I hadn't been looking at that point before, but we'll keep an eye out on that for you. Great battle at the front. Michael Gans in the last few years really, really has raised his game.
He has. He's got a group of backmarkers that they will be catching fairly soon. And that will be three cars ahead they'll be catching the next lap or two. And that could give Pirro the opportunity to find a gap that he hasn't managed to so far.
Rick Vega in that Jaguar E-type that started on the second row, 29, qualified there by Sam Hancock. He's 53 seconds behind the leader at this point of the race.
And 15 positions is this.
Here he goes, moves for the chance.
He's gone for the inside line. But Gans isn't going to give it up that easily. You want to be on the wider line if you possibly can, but certainly Pirro is making him think.
As you say, Bruce, Gans very impressive to not crack under the pressure at the moment. But now he's got a new challenge.
Which was pushed off back into the pits.
The 31 E-type in his way and the 86 Lotus in land. So traffic all over the place, around the outside. St Mary's. Pirro was so nearly off the circuit in the first part of the corner. Right to the edge and beyond. Just got the land to get past. They did that before Lambert. That was very hairy. They had to guess. And when you get ushered to the outside, the first part of St Mary's, that's not necessarily where you want to be.
Well, Pirro had faith, didn't he? Because he committed to following the Gans decision. So if there had been an incident between them, he would have been in it as well.
Rear wheel was courting the grass, wasn't it?
Oh, gosh, and how. And I'm just waiting to see if Mike Jordan is going to lose much time in the TVR, running in third place. He's the next one to come across that gaggle of cars. I think he's managed to get past as well out of my sight. But Pirro is now looking really, really serious in this chase. Always diving for the inside line, up through Woodcote one more time. But Michael Gans staying very calm, but don't forget, out of the chicane last time around, certainly Pirro must have got a better exit because he was able to punch up and almost look as though he's going to take the inside line into Madrid. This time not as close.
Pit window opens in 1.75 minutes. Gap between the leaders, 0.3, which is the most it's been for about 6 laps.
But the Whittaker TBR is only 2.5 seconds behind. Yeah. He's just constantly...
Someone's gone very off at St Mary's. The number 10 E-type has taken a line you wouldn't recommend. That's the Gom Keith Lucas car. He will be able to rejoin, but pretty much as he gets to Lavant. There we are. He's lost a few positions, but that was an interesting angle of trajectory.
Here we Gom, the Canadian.
Gans still hanging on at the lead of the race ahead of Emanuele Pirro. Emanuele's looking to the inside. Is this the chance he's been waiting for so long? Decisive he was. Is he going to run wide and let the classic cut back? No, he won't. Was that Michael Gans waving out of the window? I think it was. The exit of the corner.
Now the boot's on the other foot. And Whittaker is at a grandstand view of that from the TVR, isn't he?
Close right in. Yes, in all of that, he had been creeping closer and certainly had the better of the traffic. They were both interrupted, the two AC Cobras running first and second, a lap and a half ago in St Mary's. And Mike Jordan is getting closer and closer. There he is in the picture. So the top three are going to be covered by what? 2.5 seconds?
It's Whittaker.
Whittaker in the car, not Jordan.
He's doing a very, very good job to give Mike Jordan a fighting chance.
Former Racer CC Guards Trophy champion by Boisecamp in another of his TVRs. Andy Wolf, who put the Michael Gans driven Cobra on pole, puff of smoke from the CVR in third place. And Pearson and Young are the chasers.
Yes, those wire wheels on the Whittaker TVR just look so incongruous. There he is up right against the
lane. Oh, he's open.
Oh, yes.
And Richard Bynes immediately in to hand over to Rob Puff.
And Falk also in, and the Jeanette's in as well. Hilliard to Guess.
Okay, this will be a replay, presumably, of Manuele Pirro going up the inside into Lavin. Had just the right degree of handling as he came up the rise. And that compression into the first part of Lavin. The move was done very easily indeed. So the Jeanette, as you said, in the pits. Richard Bynes behind, handing over to Rob Huff and James Guest taking it. James Hilliard in the red and black Jeanette. Nice empty pit lane for them. Pirro now in front. He's got a lead of just under a second. But now, of course, Mike Whittaker is right on the tail of Michael Gans. So that's a defend from a different sort of chaser.
New fastest lap from Pirro, 27.0, but Whittaker's been getting quicker and quicker as well, and he's also done a 27.0, so the TVR in pretty good shape as we approach the pit window for pit stop for that car.
27.4 for Michael Gans and all of that. A lot of laps down for our race leaders.
.7 seconds covered the top three last time through, so the pit stops and the second drivers will decide the race, I think. Whittaker's kept himself very well in contention with the two Cobras.
Yes, just little things, very narrow pit lane. It's a question of which other cars are near the point you want to stop. Will you lose a second here, a second there? Because on the track they've been dealing only in fractions of the second. Number 8 E-type that was running around near the back of the field.
A little bit glitzy you saw briefly there. Won races at the very first meeting.
Look
to the
at the outside of the left-hand window, the passenger side window of the race leading Cobra. It's hanging out. The top part is angling away from the roof frame.
Whittaker in. After 12 laps. First of the top guys to stop. Mike Jordan is there. Great drive from Mike Whittaker. Out he comes.
Nice goggles on top of his helmet. Don't worry, it's only the liveries. He clangs his head on the door frame.
New fastest lap for Pirro, 126.4, which I think is quicker than he went to qualify. There's the second quick lap. What a quick second on the
26.2 was Andy Wolf's qualifying time. Of course, on light tanks at the end of the session.
That looked like a pretty quick stop from the Whittaker Jordan TBR. And I'm sure Mike Jordan will get on it pretty quickly. So looking pretty strong at the moment for them.
Come through, out of the pits in sixth place. Still ahead of the Mead and Nilan. Mead's got Nick Padwell, the outright circuit holder, in with him.
It's a pretty good lineup, isn't it?
Yeah, you know you timed your pit stops well when you don't come out behind slower cars or much slower cars, so that's a very good job from that TVR crew. Will it really throw it into their hands? We'll find out shortly. Ooh. Pirro taking to the grass. Well, that's when he realised his options were limiting. And coming towards the end of the lap, still got time. It's a 15-minute pit
window.
Gans
is through as well. Didn't Gans do well to get back past the blue Mustang to get back onto the tail of the race leader? And there is only about 3-4 lengths between those two cars. There's Shelby Mustangs everywhere.
Yeah, there were three of them together, two white ones. You can see the blue one in the background. They've been having a great scrap. But slightly broken up, but fair enough, it's the leading duo coming through.
But that will really help the Whittaker Jordan TVR, won't it? Because they did the pit stop before they had to negotiate all of this traffic. And that was a slow lap for both those leading Cobras. So if Mike Jordan can get on it quickly out of the pits, it might be enough to put him into the lead when the two Cobras stop.
Yeah, well, effectively, before the TVR came in for a pit stop, it was, 2.5 seconds covering the top three cars? Maybe slightly less than that. So, yes, it was a swift little run through the pits, but there, oh, dear me, what you gain, you lose. but Dickie Meaden sticking right to 10 of the car, but that little Lotus has to come in, whereas the TBR has made its pit stop. And the 14 Jaguar is being driven with a bit more gusto now because Rob Huff on board. A little bit of obstruction there down through Madgwick, so the TBR now with Mike Jordan having taken over from Whittaker, losing what it had gained just moments earlier.
Well, the whole beat Serena, isn't it, that's ahead of it, and I imagine that will be lapping quite quickly, so it won't be the work of a moment for Jordan to for Mike Jordan to get past it.
That's Ludo Lindsay just climbing into one of the E-types. Is Manuel Piro coming round for the 14th time.
See what I mean about the door frame? The other side of that car. So the Cobra is hanging away from the roof.
Gant is in, hand over to Andy Wolf.
How full's that pit lane? It looks full from here, full shortening shot, but no cars either in front or behind, so hopefully there's a clean entrance, hopefully a clean exit for them. Coming out backwards, Michael Gant's out. Time to shake hands, no niceties now, and Andy Wolf taking over. They were certainly a very strong pairing when it came to qualifying, and Andy Wolf took pole.
Here's Mike Jordan in the CVR. Out goes the 94 Cobra. Looks like Rob Wainwright waiting there in the pits to take a car over as well.
He's come out with a greater lead over the TBR by about, I don't know, gained about a second and a bit there, I reckon.
I think it might end up as more by the time they get to you, Bruce. The gap looks quite sizeable. So Mark Jordan's got his work cut out now, given that Andy Wolf did put that car on pole.
Trying to look to the distance, see how it is. At this point in the race, after the driver changes, you often have the first lap out is when you get incident. I just had the 86 Elan only just staying on the circuit at St Mary's on its first half lap since the pit. What's the gap coming past between Andy Wolf and Mike Jordan? I reckon it's about 4 seconds, 4 to 5 seconds. Number 17 E-type popping and banging. I think they've just had a driver change. That's the Andrew Smith, Fred Wakeman car, so I don't think that will be long for this race. Ricky Pastorelli, James Cottingham, number 111, the 64 model of the 250 GTO, going very well indeed. We've got some fabulous onboard footage from this early laps of the race from that, but for once, clear stretch of track.
Cottingham still finding time to do his belts up a little bit tighter as he goes into Ford Water.
Quite twitchy in Ford Water there. Got a gaggle of cars now up ahead. The next one he'll find fairly shortly will be the number one Bizzarini. Certainly quicker, should be able to haul that in, but lots of adjustments as James Cottingham just gets the feel of the car. Watch the track grip, level of grip. I think he's just about worked it out now. He's got a half a lap in, and we'll see some overtaking from him soon.
5.8 seconds between Wolf and Jordan. Jordan's just done the best lap of that car, a 26.7, which is 3/10 of Piro's fastest lap. Piro's still out there in the lead. Yes, I see what you mean, Bruce, about the loose window. Shouldn't be troubling him too much, older than I thought. It's not flapping around excessively.
No, it was just in case it got worse, but still, you know, eventually they'll coax Emanuele into the pits. Is it going to be this time? No, going on one more. Still got 6.5 minutes before he has to definitely make his pit stop.
Yeah, he's got plenty of time.
So the 17 E-type, I said it was popping and banging. A couple of the Mustangs coming in, but 17 sadly with his bonnet up in the pit lane. Expect that to be really running at full speed anymore. Fred Wakeman and Andrew Smith. There's the number 7 Mustang, been enjoying that great battle with number 4 and one other of the Mustangs down in the middle order. Don't have the legs of the top card, but still look good. Great out on the search.
Gary Pearson has brought the Tiffany LM in to hand over to John Pearson. He'd got the car up to 5th before the pit stops and had run as high as 3rd once the lead started coming in.
Yep, so at the moment it's the Piro Lynn AC Cobra number 13 leading the race. Andrew Haddon, Ben Shuckburgh, their AC Cobra number 6, the red one in third place, and then just waiting as the rest are now starting to make their pit stops. The order will be shuffled, but really we're waiting to see, is it going to be a good pit stop? They could be about the last to make the pit stop.
Last car on the lead lap is the lad, isn't it? So.
Dickie Meaden.
Yeah, Meaden and Padmore. LM is out.
I honestly think that when the 13 Cobra comes in from the lead of the race, it will be one of the last in the pit lane, so it should have a very empty pit lane, which is always a good thing.
John Pearson now in the LM, resumes in seventh place ahead of the white Aston Martin. This is Wilmot, that's still Wilmot, sometime Formula 3 racer in that.
New fastest lap for Pierre Audin, 126.2. And he needs to be doing that because Mark George is in the 26 as well, high 26 from TBR. And Andy Wolfe did a 27.5 the last time through. I imagine he might be thinking now that he's not, doesn't appear to be in traffic. So Piero does need to make sure he keeps that pace up for the stops. Another 27.4 for Wolfe this time through.
Going into the pits. Jack Young, his lad's going to take over.
As is Meaden with the Elan.
Good strong run from Meaden there. Manuel Impero still going. He's got another less than 4 minutes now until the pit stop has to be done and dusted. Will it be this lap? Will it be the next one? You can still see the door frame sort of hanging loose on the passenger side of that AC Cobra. Doesn't seem to affect Emanuele. Luckily, it's not the door they're going to have to play with during the pit stop.
Into the pits. Leader, Emanuele Impero in car number 13 with 18 and a half minutes still to go.
He's right down by pit exit. No one should be parking in front of him, so it should be a nice, clean exit. Pat on the behind for Sean Lynn as he gets on board. Emanuele, we know there's a smile inside that helmet.
Rob Huff has just done 26.9. Well, he's on the region starting, he's 10th. So
yeah, but the thing is, Kevin, when he came out, he was enmeshed in the worst of the traffic for a handful of laps.
Just got Andy Wolfe.
It's going to be close.
Well, Sean Lynn's come out ahead and should just be ahead. Yes, he's getting up to full speed as he goes down to the corner. So it's pretty much as they were before the pit stop, so about 1 and a bit seconds.
Yeah, Wolf's absolutely up to speed, though, isn't he? And he's got a couple of laps under his belt. Feeling his car, he knows it's good.
Yeah, how confident is he going to be to press on really quickly? Because as you said, Wolf has got a couple of laps under his belt. Really getting the car started by Michael Gans, pole position, the 94 Cobra up to speed. The 111 has spent the whole race making its way forward. James Cottingham took over from Nicky Pastorelli and listed at the moment at ninth position, but still with a handful of cars to make pit stops ahead of him. That should gain some more positions now, right on the tail of the Lotus that Dickie Meaden started. Nick Padmore on board at the moment, so they'll be having a good laugh after all these historic races and know each other very well indeed. Padmore had to change angle comprehensively too.
That was very close, isn't it?
Well, to jink around the back marker, and then that was absolutely putting trust in the fact your car was an exact distance wide, because there was an exact distance plus 2 inches either side between there and the pit wall.
Well, and the people on the pit wall could get the pit balls in quickly enough not to smash through some of them. Everyone being sufficiently alert, fortunately.
Here's Ralphie Haddon in at 18 laps. 19 laps he will be doing.
Yeah, he drove well there. He kept the leaders in sight.
Yep.
A strong run in the 6 Cobra.
He's won the Spa 6 hours before. As Andrew Haddon, Ralphie to his mates.
Mike Jordan, he's closing on the leading Cobras. He was 5.8 seconds behind Wolf after the pit stops. He's down to 4, so he's chipping away. And if the Cobras start getting involved with each other again, then I think he will make it a 3-way fight for the lead before the end.
1.1 seconds between the Gans Wolf Cobra.
Now, the 111 Ferrari markers, great shots looking forward, but right behind him and pressing very, very. He's being pressed really, really hard, and it's good the Dickie Meaden Lotus has been passed, but Rob Huff is on an absolute charge. There is Huff coming right up the inside. Is he going to dive in? Another 14 E-type, not into the chicane. Thank goodness we caught him from the outside, but. Know how much James Cottingham saw him coming faster and faster. But the car with the pale blue nose is really on the move now. A few slow laps in traffic off the pit stop. since he took over from Richard Mines, but certainly Rob Huff absolutely flying. But now James Cottingham very much responding.
Now this previous lap, look at the gap between the pit wall. They were
did very nearly take one of the pit boards with him.
Squeezed through. Yeah, the Huff Jaguar and the young Cobra right up behind Cottingham.
Mike Jordan is on a really stonking lap. He's done the two best sectors of all. We lost a bit of traffic at the end. It's a 26.8. He's now only 2.7 seconds behind the Cobra. So we are going to have a three-way fight for the lead very soon.
James Cottingham in the Ferrari GT064. He's last year's winner, albeit at that point in a Shelby America Daytona Coupe rep.
Ferraris have swapped out, haven't they? The 111 car is now up to fifth in the Pearson LM. Has fallen down during that pit stop sequence.
Andy Wolf, 0.229 seconds behind, and gained the second that lap. Third is Jordan in the TVR. Fourth is Ben Shukra, isn't it? It's Ben Shukra, still incorrectly on our screen.
That's on his own.
And it's going to be 1-1-1.
Decidedly not on his own. He's Cottingham in the Ferrari with Rob Huff right behind him in the E-type.
I think we can safely say decidedly not on his own is Sean Lynn in the lead of this race, because Andy Wolf has got through 10, and look at the TVR.
Straight for the lead.
Mike Jordan catching with every yard of the track lead. They navigate, but down towards the chicane one more time. It's still the Will Bent livery in AC Cobra, number 13 in the lead of the race. But look, they are now officially nose to tail.
One thing that the covered something of the polystyrene coating on the chicane.
Wolf did not have a good run out of chicane, and he's having to think more about defending from Mike Jordan into Madrid than he is about having a look at Sean Lynn.
Yeah, a little bit of polystyrene all over the road there. I wonder if he got out in it or what. Oh, a massive slide for Mike Jordan into Madrid. That was awesome.
And he just sent the lead fast lap at 26.2, which I think is now quicker than the pole time.
The Jag it was that clipped the wall as he went through. Yes. And that was Rob Huff.
Rob Huff, yes, trying to straight line the chicane as much as possible, and a little bit too much there.
Well, Mike Jordan's lost a little bit of ground. There's a Mustang between. The number four Mustang got in the way, but look at Andy Wolf. He's now twitching right under the tail of Sean Lynn, almost touching him as they went into the first part of the lap. Had to hit the brakes a little bit. Probably didn't want to do that very much. That's allowed Lynn a little bit of breathing space.
Lynn had a bobble there on the exit of that as they go onto the back straight. That means Wolf has got a run on him. Can he get up alongside?
He can.
Yes, he can. He's
made it
the lead.
Through on the straight.
Yeah, but look at Jordan. He's now right on the tail of the 13 East Cobra. He's going to hope unsighted he can go around the outside. Is he going to tuck now back into the inside? No, great move there, but one little mistake by one on the way in and one on the way out. But for 13, for Sean Lynn, it's cost him. But now he's a bit loose into the chicane, being pushed really hard by Mike Jordan in the 68 TVR.
He has to get past quickly, doesn't he?
Delighted Michael Gans.
Pull away.
Delighted Michael Gans beams off the pit board and waves his fist at Andy Wolf.
Yeah, but there are a dozen minutes on the clock.
There's still
plenty of time for this order to be reshaped at the front. But the slides that Mike Jordan's getting through on that TVR Griffith, almost as wide as it is long. So much power under the hood.
He'll be desperate to get past Sean Lynn as quickly as possible, won't he? Bit of smoke from the left rear there as it went through Ford Water.
One thing the TVRs tend to lack is brakes. They push really, really hard. They're smaller brakes than they are on the Cobra. It's just a
well, he's up the inside.
He's squeezed down the inside of Sean Lynn into 11th, and he's made it through as Mike Jordan. Absolutely sensational.
Well, he worked that very well indeed. So Lavin hasn't been a good corner for two consecutive laps for the 13 AC Cobra crew. So Sean Lynn now back in third place. Now, what can Mike Jordan and the TVR do? Because 94 just up ahead isn't escaping. Andy Wolf made the move a lap ago to take the lead from Sean Lynn, trying to escape, but he's got a car between himself. Just the one car.
He's died hard, that was good.
Jordan was so super positive, he had to get in before the chicane, but we know the chicane effectively is narrower this year. Boy, passion on the pit wall. They want place changes, they want their drivers back at the front. Sean Lynn's got to stay in this battle.
That's the Nigel Rubin motorsport team. Nigel, the guru of these cars. Stuff, the Midlands.
Imagine that to go really deep into four doors.
And that's Rob Wainwright in the Alain Coupe, the historic Formula Ford racer, who's won numerous races in the championships. Another twitch from Andy Wolf. He goes past the 27 Mustang. That's the Sleep family entry.
Cottingham was seen off from Huff in the battle for fifth.
Yeah, well, Huff
with a bigger gap.
Yeah, Huff got close and it's gone out the other way. Cottingham took a little while to settle down and then he's really, really worked it very well the past two or three laps.
Well, he's just done a 26.6, which is actually quicker than all of the leaders. And he's quicker than everyone except for Sam Hancock in the 29 E-type as he battles back.
Oh, there's a Jaguar going cutting the daffodils.
That is not allowed. So second place still in the hands of Mike Jordan. He's 1.3 seconds down and last time around. Has the gap gone out? I think it probably has a little bit. 1.5 seconds, only by 2/10. But the real key is where is the traffic? There's one back mark between he in the number 68 TBR and the car that he is chasing, the car that's been in the lead the race for about 2.5 laps now, the 94 AC Cobra.
Yes, they exchange tenths, don't they, when they've got clearo, but you can lose a couple of seconds if you get the traffic wrong. So Mike Jordan's still very much in this race, I think.
We've got Sam Hancock in 29 up into 10th place. He's closing all the while on the Ferrari LM of John Pearson this half of the race. Still 8.5 minutes to go.
Mike Jordan's been a little bit unfortunate with the traffic on this lap.
Yeah, he's got Nick Padmore to try and make him the gap. And Jack Young just ahead. That's a battle for position for Padmore and Jack Young.
Or down the middle.
Padmore, who won last year's FIA Masters Historic Formula One Championship in Max Smith Hilliard's Williams FW07. Second record holder here in the historic era.
What I'm looking forward to see is, can Mike Whittaker afford to be as flamboyant as he has been in the earlier laps? Sorry, this is Mike Jordan now, but this car was thrown around in the early laps of the race. How good are the tyres at the moment? That's the question. Certainly, that flamboyant style really can eat. But what's the gap? It was 1.5, it's 1.6 seconds now. He's losing about 2/10 of a lap, second per lap. But where's the traffic? That is the key.
I think he lost more than that in the traffic. So I think Mike Jordan's done an excellent job when he's had a chance at that lap to minimise the loss. So now he's got some... Now they've both got a bit of clear out, haven't they? Bruce, what's the next car ahead of it? Coming down to you now.
Well, they're coming through Ford Water. I haven't had a car go through St Mary's for quite a number of seconds, so they should have possibly about three or four laps untrammelled by traffic. And Mike Jordan, yeah, well, he's getting the tail out on that TBR, but tucking it back in very neatly. He's got the charge, and he was really interrupted. Of course, he had two cars between himself and the race leader down at this very point. Last lap, did lose out, so he is hauling him back in. You're right, Kevin.
Chakra doing a grand job in the number 6 Cobra. He's fourth. He's way clear of Cottingham in the Ferrari. Cottingham last year's Graham Hill Trophy race winner. The single driver race back then. Cottingham being chased by Rob Huff in sixth place.
Best middle sector of the entire race by Mike Jordan. He is homing in on the back of the Cobra. Oh, and he's really trying hard. He was sideways there. Out of Woodcombe, but the TBR is basically with him. We've got 6.5 minutes to go and we do have a dice for the lead.
The Nigel Roman team going wild as they urge Mike Jordan on.
125.5 for the TBR. That's an incredible lap time.
0.349 of a second. That is nothing. And the absolute most fantastic thing of all of this, there is no traffic that they're going to hit for quite some while. They're halfway between Madrick and Ford Water. The 31 Jaguar is just leaving the second part of St Mary's, so they've got the rest of this race, I think, with clear track, which is absolutely brilliant. If anyone's going to win this, if Mike Jordan's going to win this, he's got to do it fair and square without interruption.
Absolutely. I bet Andy Wolf can't believe he's just done a 1:26.8 around Goodwood in a GT race and has lost 1.3 seconds to the guy he's chasing.
Little mistake from Andy Wolf. He had to change his cornering angle as he went through the second part of St Mary's, and he's lost a bit of momentum, but he's driving very defensively. You can't come to the outside. I've got that covered. Now I'm coming to the inside, so Mike Jordan have to think of something else. But look how close the TVR is to the tail. The 68 right behind 94 now.
Jordan's having a go, isn't he, Kev? At the outside this time.
He's so confident on the brakes, I think he might do it.
Oh, he's made it round the outside.
Move of the meeting. That was the move of the meeting. By golly, that was brave. What are they going to do this time? Nigel Rubin's going to explode on the pit wall, I think.
He would if he wasn't in Jamie Booth's TVR.
Of course he is, yes.
That was absolutely brilliant. Andy Wolf isn't going to take it lying down, is he? Come back at Jordan. Sean Lynn's fallen away in third place.
He fell away remarkably quickly once he got separated by traffic.
Cottingham Huff are going to catch Shukra, aren't they, over the next couple of laps. And that's all they've got, really, to play with. But I think they will be up into fourth and fifth places before the chequered flag falls.
I don't think it's good. Well, we can see it's not going to be a clear run to the finish because the 31 E-type is not so far ahead of them, and the TVR with Mike Jordan leading the race, and the 94 Andy Wolf AC Cobra are lapping way, way quicker. As they go through the first part of lap into the second part, and they will be able to see in front of them. Oh, they've got the number 8 E-type as well. That's, I think, the slowest car in the race at the moment. They should get past that nice and easily before Woodcote, but I think they might catch the 31 just where they don't want to find him with 3.5 minutes on the clock. They got past the 8 E-type nicely before Woodcote. They won't be troubled by the 31 E-type. The next car they've got to pass until after they come out of the chicane. They should blast past it. Well, actually, just before Madwick, or actually at Madwick. That could be critical.
That's Mike Whittaker on the pit wall there in the blue jacket. Started the leading TVR, number 68.
Well, Andy Wolf said he's hit the best lap time of that car for the whole race. He's absolutely fighting the Cobra to hang on to the TVR. He's done 26.6. But I think,
again, he's slaying the rear tyres, isn't he?
Absolutely. I think with a clear road, I think Marchand has just got a bit too much pace for him.
Well, in fact, on the drop down from Ford Water, the advantage creeping out, and importantly, the TVR is passed before they get to St Mary's, past the 31 E-type, and just before St Mary's.
This is Cottingham catching Shukra.
He's caught him very quickly, actually, isn't he?
Yes, and Huff's not that far behind. You'll probably see him in the background in a second. He goes, looks up the inside. Shukra gets a little bit tweaked up. So does Cottingham.
Well, that'll let Huff close in a little bit there and then compromise.
The gear knob's come off the Ferrari.
That's devalued it by quite some many thousands, I feel.
Available from DK Engineering, apparently.
And there in the background, the E-type with the blue nose is Rob Huff, 2.5 minutes remaining on the clock. I don't think he's going to be able to catch 111, but he's going to give it a good go. But James Cottingham, as we saw, traffic affected him there. He's managed to get past the 6 AC Cobra, yeah. So he's heading into fourth place.
He is, and I think Huff will make it into fifth, but I think you're right. I think Cottingham has enough for him. We saw Huff giving him some pressure early in the race, and the Ferrari drew away, didn't it? So clear road, the Ferrari is quick enough. And up at the front, Mike Jordan has now got 1.4 seconds in hand. It's slipping away from the Wolf Cobra.
There'll be one more lap after this. Down to traffic, I sense now, Kevin.
I think this is a really strong drive for Mike Jordan, isn't it? In fairness, Mark Whittaker's set it up well, kept the car in contention. They actually lost a bit of ground during the pit stop sequence. Their stop didn't look bad, but they lost a few seconds. But Mike just kept charging.
Well, it certainly seemed in the pit stop sequence the advantage was with the late stopping Emanuele Pirro. Nobody in front of him in the pit lane, but I'm afraid that Sean Lynn got monstered by them, and he has been dropped to some degree. 15 seconds back off the lead now, 16 seconds back off the lead, Sean Lynn. So he'll come home third, but Pastorelli will be a dog. Pastorelli, Cottingham would be giving chase, but it does look as though victory is going to go to Mike Jordan.
And Huff is now.
Huff was so sideways out of the chicane that time. He's ahead now of Ben Shukra. That's done a fine job in that car, which was started by Ralphie Haddon. And 30.
There's
the ultimate lap of the race.
Yeah, Sean Lynn trying to bring that home. He will in third place. We just saw fleeting ahead of him Andy Wolf, who looked good for victory, but the pace of Mike Jordan in particular, after he's taken over from Mike Whittaker, absolutely fantastic. Going on to his final lap, would it be about 1.5 seconds his margin? Might be slightly more than that. How did it go out to 7.6 seconds?
Yeah, no idea.
Wolf must have had a big moment somewhere. He's at 1:34, which is
6 seconds off his pace.
6 to 8 seconds off what he was doing earlier. Yeah. So is he up to speed now?
No, he's not. He's been overtaken by the 29 Jag, which of course is Hancock. There is a problem with the Cobra.
Right now in St Mary's is the TVR. Well, I'm just looking back to see where the 94 is on the circuit. Can't picture from the outside how much time he's losing, but he is limping at home.
Is it down on one side?
I think it could be. I'm just trying to see. Sean Lynn is about 6 seconds behind. Yeah, you can pick him up in the background, but certainly don't forget that it was about a 6 second loss on the previous lap. I think, unless the problem gets worse, Andy Wolf will have just enough to come home in second place. There's no doubting who's going to win the race, though.
TVR are going to pull a major surprise here this afternoon at the 75th Goodwood members meeting. Owned and driven initially by Mike Whittaker, trained by Nigel Rubin, written again brilliantly by Mike Jordan. 68 TVR Griffith 400 is going to come home victorious over the Cobras and the Jags and the Ferraris and everything else that we've thrown out. There is Mike Whittaker. Harry Hope Frost is now kissing him. Oh no, he's the kiss, he's the kissee rather than the kisser. 94.
Well, Wolf's done just enough. Place.
Andy Wolf in second. And it's going to be third, Sean Lynn, not far at all behind Andy Wolf at the flag, 2.5 seconds.